Hiya everybody from YouTube and on Facebook, and tomorrow this episode is going to be on my podcast, Máiréad Mondays, Chats, Choons and Craic, and be sure not to miss that as well. And I am so excited to have a brilliant friend of mine. He is so amazing, a genius, drummer, percussionist. He's my pal from Celtic Woman, Ray Fean, and Ray is going to be joining us later. I can't wait to catch up with Ray, and we always have the chats, and we always have great crack as well. So it's going to be amazing. And in honor of Ray coming on later on, the very first time I met Ray Fean, I believe, was when we did this amazing Celt program together with the fantastic Donal Lunny, and I have my collaboration video is from there, and I am just going to play that now. You'll see amazing musicians, John McSherry on pipes, Nolly Casey on fiddle, myself, Donal Lunny of course, and of course the brilliant Ray Fean on drums. Enjoy this. Get you in the spirit of things, I don't know what will. My goodness, we just loved playing those tunes, amazing tunes by Donal Lunny, and oh, we had the best time. And that's the first time I met Ray Fean. A lot of you think it was probably Celtic Woman, but it was actually way before Celtic Woman, as you saw there. And just, oh, it's just amazing making music all these years, you know. And I just want to see now what my brother Carl Nesbitt is up to on his YouTube channel. And he's going to be saying a big hi to Ray as well. I know he's probably tuning in. And Carl is a prodigious talent, the Irish Music Magazine. And I just want to see what Carl has been doing on his YouTube channel. Some amazing videos up there and tutorials, and apart from being a brilliant musician and performer, he is an amazing educator. So if you're lucky, do go to his email, flutetricks@hotmail.com, flutetricks@hotmail.com, and you know, you might get a lesson with him, who knows. Anyway, here we go. This is a brilliant two reels, O'Connell's Trip to Parliament and Paddy Mills' Reel. Paddy Mills' Reel is also known as Follow Me Up. And sure, you can follow Carl on his YouTube channel. Why not? he's a talented young fella. Oh, on the flute and bouzouki and bar on there, and some amazing tutorials there on his YouTube channel. And well, I just want to thank everybody too very much this week for ordering from MáiréadNesbittViolin.com and solstice.shop. It is so important to support your musicians right now, and I cannot complain, guys. Thank you so very much for supporting me on all my platforms. And I just want to say a big thank you to the star orders today, Robert Poulan, and he is from Colorado, USA, and Marcia Eckland from Montana, USA. And you guys got my Hibernia solo CD. Thank you so very much, guys. And I've signed those for you and put in personalized cards as well. And, you know, as I said, it's fantastic to get the support from my website, MáiréadNesbittViolin.com. Thank you so much, guys, too, for coming back for your lessons. Practice, practice, practice makes perfect. We all know that. And it was just so great to see everybody this week. And I just want to thank Lisa Bybee, New Hampshire, USA, Brianna Lulliver in Canada, Elizabeth Callahan, California, USA, Tiffany Moore, Chicago, USA, Kathy Thibberville in Texas, USA, Catherine Richter, South Carolina, USA, and Christopher Baker in Tennessee, USA. So great to see you all. And it's so easy to book your lessons on MáiréadNesbittViolin.com. No shipping. So it's a winner, you know, when you can get all your bundles and great deals there. And let's see, I have a big hello as well to everybody at home from Ireland, because they're all going to be here to see Ray. And I have also another clip from Carl Nesbitt on the bouzouki. Here we go.
I know you all know by now that I love to play a tune from my mother, Kathleen Nesbitt's fiddle, tutorial and 41-track CD, and it's available from MáiréadNesbittViolin.com. And I have a great polka for you today. Polkas are very lively, and the set dancers in Ireland love dancing to them. And this tune is called The Dark-Haired Girl Dressed in Blue, and it's on page 91 of the book. Folks, I do have a Celtic spell for you today, and it is concerning the four cycles of the four major cycles of early Irish literary tradition. So here we go. This is really, really interesting. The mythological cycle is one of the four major cycles of early Irish literary tradition, the others being the Ulster cycle, the Fenian cycle, and the cycles of the kings within Irish mythology, concerning a set of tales around the godlike peoples said to have arrived in six migratory invasions into Ireland. The Book of Invasions, or Lara Gabala Éireann, is a collection of prose and poems in the Irish language. The earliest version is from the 11th century. It tells of Ireland being taken and settled six times by six groups of people: the Cæsar, the people of Partholone, the people of Nemaid, the Fir Bolog, the Two-Headed Danann, and the Gaels. The first four groups were wiped out and forced to abandon the island. The fifth group represent Ireland's pagan gods, and the final group represent the Irish people, or the Gaels. Mythology of pre-Christian Ireland was preserved in the oral tradition. This oral tradition is known as Béal Iddis. This is translated, Iddis is education and Béal is mouth. So handed down orally the whole tradition. In the 11th century, the first manuscripts were written in Ireland, preserving many of these tales in medieval Irish literature. Though the Christian influence is also seen in these manuscripts, the literature represents the most extensive and best preserved of all the branches of Celtic mythology. The first cycle, the mythological cycle, traces the ancestry of the Irish back to before Noah. It tells of a series of invasions or takings of Ireland by a succession of peoples, the fifth of whom was the people known as the Tuatha De Danann, the peoples of the goddess Danu, who are believed to have inhabited the island before the arrival of the Gaels. With the arrival of the Gaels, the Tuatha De Danann retired underground to become the fairy people of later myth and legend. So that is the Celtic spell for today, everybody. Hope you liked it, and there'll be more next week. Here I am back again. And hopefully you got to hear that Celtic spell, and hopefully I didn't make a mistake. Hopefully you all heard me there. Very good. And I am so, so excited to welcome Ray Fean really soon. And I'm going to talk about Ray. He doesn't need any introduction, but I'm going to talk about Ray a little bit anyway. He is absolutely amazing. And At the age of 13, Ray Fean commenced his drumming career with a local rockabilly band. This introduced him to Dixie and Texas swing, blues, shuffle, and more progressive American styles. Raised in a musical household, and the brother of guitarist Johnny Fean of the Celt rock supergroup Horselips, Ray was surrounded by a diverse range of ethnic music styles. Gypsy swing, Eastern European and American roots gave him insight into integrating rhythms with those which he had already experienced. By the age of 16, Ray had mastered the variants of swing and playing different percussion accents. As things progressed, Ray began involved with the more creative side of music, writing and recording. This led to joining Tuesday Blue, a Limerick band which had been picked up by Adam Clayton and signed to U2's mother label and EMI Manhattan. After Tuesday Blue, Ray concentrated on session work with a variety of different bands, living for a period of time in New York and working from Sears Studios in Manhattan. Ray toured and recorded with such artists as Clannad, Paul Brady, Sinead O'Connor, Joe Elliott of Def Leppard, Elvis Costello, Emmylou Harris, Neil and Tim Finn of Crowded House, Sharon Shannon, Davy Spillane, and Kirsty MacColl. Ray then spent a year touring worldwide with the groundbreaking super show Riverdance. It was during this period that Ray joined up with Donal Lunny, one of Ireland's foremost musicians and producers. Initial productions included the Common Ground album, featuring a variety of different artists, Bono and Adam Clayton of U2, Maya Brennan of Clannad, Christy Moore, Kate Bush, and more. Donal and Ray then collaborated with Dan O'Brass, a Breton guitarist and songwriter, on the Heritage de Celtes project, featuring a host of international Celtic artists. Touring throughout Europe, the show has created several platinum-selling albums. With Donal, Ray became an integral part of the formation of progressive Irish music ensemble Coolfin, and that's where I first met Ray. Touring extensively worldwide, Coolfin have worked with such luminaries as the Kodo Drummers of Japan and completed a 16-week music series for Irish National Television, RTE, and for the BBC. The show was called Sult, Spirit of the Music, featuring the renowned international artists. As I said before, that's where I met Ray for the first time. Ray has been involved in so many diverse international musical projects. These include collaboration and composing, arrangement and production of the orchestrated musical score for the Canadian movie Divine Rhymes, writing and producing the scores in Japan, and being featured artist, composer and arranger of the Japanese-produced documentary series Deep Planet. On the home front, Ray's work as a principal drummer, percussionist, and is featured on many tracks for artists including U2, David Gray, Gabrielle, Emma Bunton, Abs and Belfire. Ray toured for years and was the original drummer and percussionist of supergroup Celtic Woman, and most recently is featured on the hit show Come From Away, the UK production in London on the West End. And, you know, he's absolutely amazing. Here's Ray again in action with me, with Celtic Woman. Absolutely amazing. And we're giving it loads there on stage. So I just want to welcome Ray. Hi, Ray. It's so great. So great to see you. I see you have a fiddler. You have a fiddler crossing sign. Fantastic. From the Máiréad Fan Forum. Oh, Ray, thank you for coming on.
It's great to see you, love. Absolutely brilliant to see you. Too long. It's been way too long, hasn't it?
It's been too long. And also, you know, we've so much to talk about. You absolutely do. So yeah. Much to talk about. And I've loads of great clips for people to listen to, and they're gonna love it. And you know, let's go backwards. You know,
any incriminating evidence now or anything like that?
Well, I'll try and dig up something on the way. There you go.
Okay.
With Come From Away, Ray, this is amazing. On the West End, that must have been absolutely amazing to be a part of.
Yeah, that kind of like, as a friend of mine says, we always manage to bumble from one success to the other. And in this instance, yeah. I was barely out of Celtic Woman, and I was, you know, on the way would Come From Away, which to anyone that might know, it looks something like this, if you can see it there.
Yes, we can. It is a great show.
Something like 16 awards, and including Tonys and Olivier's and all that kind of, like, it's an absolutely fantastic show. And I was coming back to play with Horselips in March, and then that was the end of that. But I'd been dipping in and out with Horselips. I love the show over there. And I liked getting off the road for a while. I liked not traveling or being in a bed that moves around the place. So, you know, I'm glad to be in London and kind of settle down, I suppose, if you like. But it's not to say I won't go touring again, but maybe someday.
Well, there's so many comments coming in, Ray, and just loads of comments from people you know and love. Lots of, Bernadette. Bernadette says a big hi. And Neil Grover says a big hi. I am the inventor of that zildjian spiral symbol that Ray has in the photo. So there you go.
Neil is used all the time.
Yeah. He's an amazing percussionist, and of course Neil is the principal percussionist with the Boston Pops for the last 40 years. So he's absolutely, it's great to have him tuning in today. So lots of comments coming in, Ray. And of course, you know, the collaboration video I had up, Ray, was the very first time we met. And that on Salt, the Spirit of the Music. Wasn't that the most amazing show to be on?
I think I ran on adrenaline for the entire time. Because if you remember correctly, we would receive the homework for the next show the following day, the night before. Yeah. We had to have it already in the studio. And I usually hear Philip King say, taxi for Fean. That's what I'd hear in the morning, get out now. But it was really exciting and exhilarating. And we were brand new, you know, like we were just Donald assembled this super group. There was nothing we couldn't do with it. Like that's what I loved about it. We could play anywhere, in a bucket and in a stadium, and we could do anything at the time. So it was really, really exciting. I loved it. I loved every minute of that.
Oh, me too, Ray. And, you know, it was, so many years ago, and it was so fantastic. I was pretty young at the time as well, I remember. Yeah. And, to play with Nolly.
You were great.
Yeah.
You were, yeah.
You know, yeah. I mean, it was just to play with Donal, Lunny, and Nolly Casey on the fiddle, John McSherry, who was a young fella. And, you know, it was so fantastic and really groundbreaking band, I really, truly feel. And if anyone is lucky enough to listen to Common Ground as well the album you did with all those stars as well, with Donal. It's just one of my most favourite albums.
Yeah, oh, lovely, yeah. But there were some great moments on that. Well, each track was handpicked. And, Gerald Seligman was at the helm there from EMI in England. Yeah. And it was just just one thing happening after another the whole time. It was just very exciting. I just couldn't believe it. It was just getting better and better. But then eventually, you know, things change. And I think we got 6 good years out of Cool Fin.
Yes, we did.
That's a long time, you know. So
absolutely. And I think the highlight for us, Ray, with Cool Fin was going over and touring Japan with the iconic Kodo drummers.
That was great. Yeah.
That was very inspiring for you too, Ray.
I mean, it was like we flew into Tokyo and then we traveled across the whatever sea it is to go to Sado Island, which is where the Kodo train and rehearse and all that and live. I just love Japan. I just love getting into Japan. So Nabi was looking after me. He was my interpreter and stuff. And I had a banana in my hand. And I said, I'll tell you what, Nabi, I'm going to learn my first Japanese word. He says, what's that? And I says, what's the Japanese for banana? And he says, banana. So that's my first Japanese word.
And, you learned really a lot exciting. There. That's great.
it was just one thing after another. You know, great, wasn't it?
I never forget that journey over across the sea, wherever it was.
Just amazing. And and really, it was like almost arriving on hallowed ground.
Yes,
seriously, absolutely. Coming on to Saddam Island.
Yeah, absolutely. It was so different at the time. And they were so giving and so kind. They just couldn't do enough for us. And that was like, well, for a drummer, I guess, that's kind of really exciting.
Because, it is. You know, it is. Yes, for sure.
And I my biggest revelation there was the actual understanding when Takashi could interpret it, for us on the language. But he wasn't there all the time. Yeah. And for the first time, I realized that rhythm and music are the single biggest universal language on the planet. Because if we couldn't talk, we'd just play and we'd all join in. And we all communicate that way. So I just figured out music and rhythm is an actual language unto itself, you know?
Yeah,
and,
it's a universal language for sure, Ray.
Sure, yeah, yeah.
So, definitely. I think, that was a huge inspiration too for all your years. You know, of course, you did your years at Riverdance, groundbreaking show. Everybody loves Riverdance. It was just the most amazing show. And if you've any little juicy little stories from Riverdance, I'm sure there's loads. you can tell us here. We won't tell anyone. It's fine. It's really private. Where nobody watches this, it's fine.
Yeah. There you go. Look, there they are.
At all the Riverdance crew.
Yeah, there we go. Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, such a big part of your life, Ray, you know?
Yeah. But I have another surprise for you, Máiréad.
Have you?
Before you incriminate me, do you remember this?
Oh, I do. Oh,
you are.
Listen, everybody, Ray is, and this is for our podcast listeners as well, Ray is holding up a photo of myself and himself and all of Celtic Woman in the White House.
Yeah.
And I'll never forget that journey because, we've been in the White House a few times, Ray, yourself and myself. And also we've been there, interestingly, at this, which would be interesting to people around this time too, that we were played for presidents from both parties. We had the Bushes, the Clintons, the Obamas, and it was just we were neutral, we were just kind of playing absolutely. Music for whoever wanted to hear it.
Well, I think a lot of the time it seems that Celtic Woman was one of these ideal situations that you could represent Ireland with. And I know that George Bush's time in office was his second term, and it was near the end of his term, and he hadn't really come together with any of the Irish that normally presidents do. So we were brought in through all that snow, and then we had two nights in Radio City Hall afterwards. But do you remember that point when there was some kind of slight security alert and all the doors just shut down, and that was it? Inside, where did we get to Radio City?
And everybody, it was absolutely, I'll never forget the blizzard that was outside.
That's right.
We had to actually, all the instruments and the suitcases we had, okay, we got out of the White House okay after a while. And then we had to, make it to, I think our flight was cancelled and we had to bus it or train it or something New York.
Yeah, Jonathan insisted on taking the train and not taking the chance at the airport.
Yeah, and he was right. He was right.
Absolutely.
And we did a very interesting walk, guys. We didn't go back to our hotel and rest after all, after the few days at the White House. We trudged through the snow from across the streets and everything to Radio City. Yeah. And we went into Radio City and we went straight into our sound check and straight on with the show. And that's how you do it.
That's how you do that. I remember one moment, all right, when we were on the airport in Capitol Hill, and like the carousel with all the bags is right next to the door, And I brought my bag out and I kind of laid it down, and I was about to pick it up again. And this man in a long black coach says, "That's fine, Raymond. I look after that for you now." So they knew everything about us. You know what I mean? They knew absolutely everything.
They were everywhere. They were everywhere, yeah. And you know, but you know, I suppose that was probably a good thing because you know we were definitely going to get to Radio City. That's for sure.
That's for sure. Do you remember the motorcade that was all the black vehicles that were outside as well, and they all took off together? She felt like the president yourself, you know what I mean?
I know. Oh my goodness. I mean, what a story. And do you know what? It was just absolutely amazing. You know, sometimes you forget things like that, right? And I mean, it's
How nervous I was because President Bush took a while to come into the room or whatever, and I was to open up with the bar on. And I remember looking down, my hand was shaking. I was going to go, I've got to get this together here, you know. So, but it was. Aww. It was really exciting, wasn't it, Maréad?
Yeah, and the fingers, you know, as well. It was a bit cold, and, you know, the fingers had to get going. And I remember we were starting off the whole thing, Ray. I think I think we were starting off with a few reels or something. And, like, it's absolutely amazing. Anyway, I want to play this this brilliant, brilliant clip. And I remember you doing this clip, Ray, and it's basically Ray who he's demonstrating lots of different drums, and it was when we were both in Celtic Woman, and I just want to play this for everyone, Ray, and we can chat then.
Okay, excellent, Maréad. Thank you.
Hello, I'm Ray Fean, and you're very welcome to the Celtic Woman Drum World. There's a variety of drums, as you can see. First of all, we have the percussion drums. They're deep, low down, in-depth sounding drums. These create a lot of that kind of warmth and pad that gets underneath the music. They're played with these, usually. These are called blastics, and some of the patterns are like this. Let's move along to the drum kit. This is more like the backbeat of the show, so to speak. This is your 4-4 solid timekeeper type of thing. You'd recognize things like... There are other kinds of percussion in the show as well, like for instance something as simple as a pair of spoons. Stuff like that. Also, you'll see from time to time things like these being used. These are just shakers, they're kind of timekeepers, to give a kind of a warm top end sound. This is an Irish frame drum, it's known as a bowron. It is pronounced very different from the way it's written. It's written as bodhran, but it's pronounced as bowron. You may recognize it as a frame drum, like that of a Moroccan frame drum, for instance. It's principally pretty much the same thing. It's a goat skin hide, a wooden frame bent in a perfect circle to create a kind of a rich sound of low end. Now this can be played by hand, or it can also be played by stick. And I use the stick in this instance, and it sounds something like this.
That's the bar on. Woohoo!
Cheaty Macris. I forgot about that one.
Do you remember that? Yes.
I remember. Oh. We were all asked to do a kind of a feature on our instruments and stuff like that. And I think I was first up for it or something. I remember your one. They've been standing the test of time, I suppose, in a way, because that was a good long time ago, Maréad, wasn't it?
It was a good while ago, Ray. Yeah. It was. And, you know, it was just so amazing, you know, and you know, it also kind of explains to people, you know, that you're, you know, not only you're a virtuoso drummer in all different genres and percussionist, but also in instruments that people wouldn't normally see. Like,
that's true, yeah.
For instance, like spoons. You know, like you make them sound so amazing, and Yeah, and I do have another clip. Now, look, this is from, I think this is from, this was taken by your sister. You see, I have my sources, right? And I do have, these are amazing. And, you know, even such a successful show, like Celtic Woman and Come From Away, we always had our sessions, didn't we? We always loved the old sessions and love entertaining people afterwards who might have been to the show in the hotel. They might have checked in and before the show. And here you are demonstrating fabulous, I have to say, amazing playing on the spoons and also on a little acoustic box. You might explain what that is afterwards with the brushes, okay?
Absolutely.
Brilliant. Yes. Let's have a look at this.
Exactly.
And I mean, absolutely,
we kind of like we play our hour and a half, but then we might do 4 hours in the bar afterwards as well, and it was always a better session. It always was. You asked about that little box that there is known as a cajon, which as far as I know is the Latin American for drawer, because what they used to do was pull out a drawer and sit and play it, but it developed into this thing called a cajon. But that version of it is known as a mini me, because it's just a small cajon. Oh yeah, before I forget, I want to have a big reach out to Carl. It was brilliant to see Carl. Really
good. That's what I just want to say, because Carl is actually watching and he says a big love to you, and all the Nesbitts in Tip are say big hi, Ray, my mom and dad, and of course Carl and everybody. Yeah. So there.
Now that we're going to get all sentimental, you know the way you said you were getting a bit homesick?
Yes. What did you do? Oh, the apple tart.
That's from the lads here.
My mother loves, and my father actually, my father loves apple tart. Apple tart and a bit of ice cream.
Yeah.
You know?
Well, what we're going to do is stick a stamp in it and send it over to you.
Well, listen, you won't have to, Ray, because I'm going to Ireland next week.
Brilliant.
I am. And that's news to everybody, but I have to go into my 2 weeks isolation. And then I'll be 3 weeks in TIP. So I can't wait. So it's going to be absolutely brilliant. Yeah. And so Ray, look, getting on to Celtic Woman, of course, everyone knows Celtic Woman and they know us both from Celtic Woman. And, you know, I think it's, I mean, what an amazing time for us all.
It was like we filmed at the Helix. And if I remember correctly, we were brought in late in the proceedings of those rehearsals. But I remember the feeling of being in the Helix and doing all this music and filming. And there was something very, very exciting about that at the time. But we didn't, like, that was all put aside and getting, you know, they were going to make it ready for PBS in the States and so on. And we were in St. Petersburg at a party backstage with RIVERDANCE. And Julian said that company was closing for a while. And I was kind of going, all right, what are we going to do now? And I was talking to the promoter, Morris Cassidy. And I said, Julian, I wonder what's going to happen next. He says, in his staunch Northern Irish accent, he says, "Ach, you'll be about the business now, a bit of work, you know." And I says, what do you mean? Do you remember that show you did in the Helix? He says, yeah. It's after taking up a 97 rating with PBS in the States. Well, I nearly fell over. And there you go, fumbling from one success to the other. So there was no looking back after that, Marie.
I know, there was no looking back, that's for sure. Yeah. And what a phenomenon, you know, and also really a family. It still is a family, you know.
Yeah.
And
absolutely, yes, very much so. You were phenomenal in it, like just people couldn't believe how you could run and play and do all that at the same time. But anyone that ever asked me about that and say, how does Marie do all that? I says, well, funny you should mention it, because she had learned that in Lord of the Dance, right?
Yeah.
And Flackley says to you, she says, no, I want action girl here. And
exactly. You know, I mean, us all watching Flackley on stage, Michael Flackley, he, you know, he really brought everything to a whole new level performance wise. You know, it was like doing a doctorate in performance looking at him, you know. I remember him saying to me, you know, just ask him, well, what do you need us to do, you know? And he said, just use the stage, and you know, it did. I loved moving around anyway, but it's you know, just so nice, and it was so amazing to be given that versatility as well in Celtic Woman, which you took on as well, Ray. And you know, you came out to do your solo from behind the drums with the bar on, which totally had the audience in the palm of your hand. Amazing solo.
Yeah, well, I loved our chemistry. Like what we did up through all those years, David Downs just let us off.
Yes.
What are you looking at me for? But he'd kind of give you a kind of a structure for it. But everything else we did was totally spontaneous between the two of us. Like all the moves and everything, they were all our own kind of moves. And mainly you, actually, Marie, because you kind of more or less choreographed the whole thing, really. I just tagged along.
Oh, stop it, Ray. Oh. But it was just amazing. And, you know, Ray, I'm always, you know, in awe of your musicianship, and it's, and also as a person, you're such a kind person, and you're very inclusive of everybody, you know, and that's what it's all about, I think, you know. And
I think that's just the way we're reared. I think both our families are like that. And that's just, you know, you're brought up to be good and mannerly and all that usual stuff. And, you know, it really does stand to you in the end, though, doesn't it?
It does stand to you. And it wouldn't be tolerated if you weren't.
Well, you get a clip around the ear, that's for sure. And probably from you, I'd see the ball going in one side and out the other.
Tony Bruno was on last week and he said I hit him a few times on stage with the bow, which I don't think I've ever hit you, Ray. You were always
no good. But I mean, I still lived in fear, you know. That's
Oh, Ray. Oh, my goodness. Yeah. And you know, just I think just everyone is just saying how much they love you. And Ray, thank you. You know, it's always too short, and I'm hoping we can meet up in Ireland at some stage.
Absolutely, we will. I'll come up the trip, and I will, and we'll grab young O'Neill up there as well. See what he's at.
Grab O'Neill as well, you know, the fantastic bass player O'Neill, and you know it's everyone's laughing at your bow. You know, so it's like kind of dental floss for the ears. Goes in one ear and out the other.
That was the dread.
That was the dreaded.
So I wonder, Máiréad, will we ever see the likes of it again? You know,
I'm hoping we will. You know, and I don't think it'll be till next year, Ray. With the live shows. But you know, isn't it great that we can get on here and just lift everyone up and just I mean, you said to me, you're just so complimentary, and you're saying how happy this is and how it just makes people happy. And that's what we both like to do, isn't it?
Exactly.
You know,
that's exactly what you're doing there, because it's weekly, and like it's great that the, you know, so many people are tuning in, and look what they're getting, like they're talking to all your friends and comrades and everything, you know. So it's a great show. Well done. And
thanks, Ray. Thank you so much for being on. And I just wanted to let people know that your podcast episode from this will be on the podcast link below tomorrow, so they'll be able to listen to it in their car while they're driving and making the dinner and
and eat an apple tart.
And eat an apple tart and ice cream. And you will too. You'll be able to hear yourself, Ray.
Oh, I don't know about that. No, I don't know about if I could stand the sound of my own voice.
But you will. And listen, I'm going to play a fantastic bit of music from Celtic Woman. You know, everybody, if it kind of goes a bit funny on Facebook, hop over to YouTube and absolutely for sure visit the podcast episode tomorrow at the link below. And I just want to say thank you so much, Ray, for being on and giving us your time and just making everyone smile and laugh. And thanks so much.
Thank you. No, I mean, all pleasure is mine, as they say. Yeah, absolutely. It's brilliant to be on. Great to see you. I will definitely see you in TIP when you're home.
See you in a few weeks. I can't wait, Ray. Yeah. Take care. Mind yourself. Love.
See y'all, lads.
Take care. Bye, Ray.
Okay, let me.
Oh, isn't it fantastic? He's just amazing and such a lovely, lovely person. And, you know, everyone, here's a video of myself and Ray in Celtic Woman. And we're joined at the very end by another amazing percussionist, Nikki Bailey. And hope you enjoy this. And as I said, if it goes a bit wonky here on Facebook, go over to YouTube and don't forget to check out Máiréad Mondays Chats, Choons and Craic tomorrow of this episode. It will be up and other episodes as well while you're at it. And hope you enjoy this video. Hey!
I know you all know I love to finish off with a tune on the viola. It's always so relaxing. And I just want to thank you all so very much for tuning in on YouTube and on Facebook and on my podcast, Máiréad Mondays, Chats, Choons and Craic. And I just want to thank my very special guest today, my pal from Celtic Woman, Ray Fean, fabulous percussionist. Thank you so much, Ray, for being on. And I want to play a beautiful tune from my mother Kathleen Nesbitt's fiddle tutorial and CD. It's called Eleanor Plunkett and it's on page 121 of the book. And I'll see you next week with a very special guest.